think for the students, this has been an extremely popular forum wherein we've had an enriching experience by all the faculty and all the organizers, especially Dr. Sripad Pujari, who himself is a speaker today, along with Dr. Kothari sir, Dr. Murthani sir, and the entire team of FINE. And it has been a very popular event in especially the trainees and students across the country. And today we start again in our today's event, the FINE Evening Tutorials of Tuesday, wherein our topic this time is toxins and the nervous system. We have Dr. Sripad Pujari sir starting with alcohol and the nervous system, followed by Dr. Tarun Nagpal sir with neurological syndromes caused by organophosphorus compound, a very, very common event in India, especially rural India. That is followed by Dr. Donde from Nanded, who will be speaking on the management and diagnosis of lathyrism, and finally Dr. Jayendra Yadav on tropical ataxic neuropathy. So without wasting much time, we have about 235 attendees as of now. We'll just go on to the first topic by Dr. Sripad Pujari sir on alcohol and the nervous system. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dhruv. I'll just share my thing. So, hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, okay, I will begin my presentation on alcohol. Probably the most commonest toxin which damages the nervous system and affects all parts of neuraxis, right from the hemispheres to the muscle. So I will try briefly to cover all areas. These are the broad points I have taken to cover my, I would say, the question to the answer to the question. So alcohol-related problems can be psychological, medical, and obviously a lot of social issues come with the patients. Can we predict who will become addicted? Actually, it's not very easy. No single personality type has shown any propensity. No aspect of alcohol metabolism has also been found to, you know, find. The exception being aldehyde dehydrogenase, we all know, and especially the Asians who have a mutant form have almost no reduced activity, wherein there is slow acetaldehyde removal, which leads to a lower frequency of alcoholism. We all know that high levels of acetaldehyde cause the, as we call, the flush reaction and the hangover symptoms, a point which has also been used to cause aversion to alcohol through drugs like disulfiram. Other factors such as personality or family problem and depression also contribute. So how does it act? It acts directly on the neuronal membranes, similar to general anesthetics. It dissolves in the cell membranes. It's a lipid soluble compound. And we all know it acts on the receptor of the inhibitory neurotransmitter GABA and also on NMDA receptors. And it is these receptors that transduce signals carried by glutamate, which we all know is excitatory, and the receptors are sensitive to extremely low levels of alcohol. Serotonin also contributes by causing drug-seeking behavior and addiction. This is a scale which broadly tells us what happens at what level. And this applies only to non-habituated persons. Between 30 to 100 milligram per level, there are stages of euphoria to ataxia, and between 200 to 400 patients, level of consciousness goes on deteriorating, and then beyond 400, it can be potentially fatal. But this is provided that the levels grow steadily, and these does not apply if in a chronic alcoholic patient because of the phenomenon of, we all know, tolerance, wherein there is an increased neuronal adaptation to alcohol. So the effects of alcohol are that it's a potent CNS depressant. It facilitates GABA and inhibits the excitation induced by NMDA. And it also has effects on other neurotransmitter systems. So prolonged heavy consumption causes reduced sensitivity of GABA, which just puts the patient at risk for development of withdrawal symptoms, and increased sensitivity to NMDA, which leads to dependency and increased tolerance. Early effects are due to modulation of cortical activity caused by inhibition of the brainstem centers, and then initially patient can have excessive activity, hyperactivity, which then later on is followed by depression in the form of slower, more inaccurate, and less specific type of responses, and there is difficulty maintaining posture and loss of control over speech, eye movements, and complex motor tasks. Cognitive function also is interfered with, which includes speed of perception, mental processing, learning, words and figures, attention, concentration, judgment, and thinking. With that, now let us actually broadly look at several ways by which alcohol affects the nervous system. Direct effects will cause paradoxical excitement and blackouts, and in pregnant women, what we know, what is termed as a fetal alcohol syndrome. And then abstinence has its, you know, four characteristic features, and then nutritional diseases. Another category is where we are uncertain whether alcohol itself is directly toxic or nutrition also plays a role. And then fifth, we all know cirrhosis and its effects on the nervous system. And then central pontine myelinolysis, we all know, is much more frequent in alcoholics, and alcohol then produces traumatic brain injury. So looking at each aspects one by one, alcohol intoxication in initial stages, as I said earlier, there is paradoxical excitement, and then slowly followed by slurred speech, incoordination, and then patient goes in a state of stupor and coma. There can be psychopathic and criminal behavior with assaultive and destructive tendencies. And then there are these blackouts, which are actually portions of short-term memory impairment. And intoxication interferes with the registration and formation of memory itself. Then the abstinence or the withdrawal, we know, has four parts: tremulousness, hallucinosis, seizures, and delirium tremens. They become manifest only after a period of absolute abstinence. Each can occur in pure form. It is not necessary that all four may be present. So tremulousness, called shakes, is combined with irritability and gastrointestinal symptoms and reaches peak around 1 to 1.5 days. And the tremor is a fast frequency, irregular, tends to diminish when the patient is in quiet surroundings, and increases by activity or stress. And it can be occasionally very violent, but sometimes there is no objective tremor, but the patient feels shaky inside. And then after a few days, it subsides, leaving patient over alert, with startle and jerky. And there are feelings of uneasiness. Hallucinations, there are two categories. The first are the initial hallucinations, where patient is also confused with disordered perception, and patients have bad dreams and disturbed sleep. It is associated with illusions, and they can be visual, auditory, tactile, olfactory, more animate than inanimate, persons, animals. And then there is another state of acute and chronic hallucinosis, where patients are not disoriented and they have intact memory. The voices by patients can be identified, and they're often attributed to family, friends. Frequently they discuss him in third person, and they're threatening. And then there is evolution in a small portion of patients to a steady state of chronic hallucinosis. He becomes quiet, although the hallucinations do remain threatening, and then ideas of reference and paranoid delusions become prominent. And then we all know withdrawal seizures, probably we treat them the commonest. Hallucinations sometimes can be treated by psychiatrists. More than 90% occur within 2 days and may go on to develop delirium tremens. And patient is unusually sensitive to moving objects and light, which is myoclonus. And GTCs are the commonest, and focal seizures always suspect a focal brain lesion. And common idiopathic and post-traumatic epilepsies can also be triggered by itself. Most patients do not require treatment. Diazepam, phenobarbital prevents withdrawal fits, and lorazepam prevents the second seizure. And benzodiazepine and phenobarbital are preferred, and phenytoin is ineffective. Delirium, again, we know, seen in a quarter, most dramatic and grave, seen in quarter, confusion, delusions, hallucinations, tremor, sleeplessness, and we all know the increased autonomic activity, which also needs treatment. It either develops in a patient who is hospitalized and then goes into DT in 2 to 7 days, or following a prolonged drinking binge after several days, then goes into delirium tremens. When he wakes up after sleepless for several days, he falls into a deep sleep, wakens lucid, and has no memory. And then there are several electrolyte abnormalities seen along with this. And there was a high mortality, but it has now gone down to 5% with very good intensive and supportive care. And patients can die due to hyperthermia. In the pathogenesis, there is hyperexcitability due to drop in serum magnesium, and also there is alkalosis. And as I earlier said, there is downregulation of GABA receptors because of chronic alcohol use. Treatment, we have to look for secondary complications, which I have enumerated, because they can be frequent and serious. Treat hyperthermia, fluid electrolyte balance. Patient can lose up to 5 liters due to perspiration, which needs to be replaced. Hypoglycemia, remember, should be preceded by thiamine, and the objectives are to blunt psychomotor activity, prevent his exhaustion, and the patient has to be calm to facilitate administration of medical and nursing care. We all know chlorodiazepam oxide and diazepam are favored, along with clonidine and beta blockers for excessive sympathetic activity. Phenothiazine should be avoided. Nutritional diseases, we have already covered these three in our last sections by Dr. I think Nandita and Nandini, and Dr. Reddy and Dr. Kaushik. So you can refer to our previous PDFs, which will give you answers to these questions. Now, moving on to those with uncertain pathogenesis, one of the most important is alcoholic cerebellar degeneration, which by far is the commonest cause of, alcohol is the commonest cause of acquired cerebellar degeneration, with male preponderance. At middle ages, with long-standing alcohol use and associated with polyneuropathy. And the syndrome is very stereotyped, predominantly involves the gait and trunk and limb more in the legs than the arms, and nystagmus, ocular signs, dysarthria, and wear, which help to differentiate from burning encephalopathy. And both nutritional and direct toxicity are postulated. We all know the pathologic changes are seen in the vermis and anterior lobes of the cerebellum, with destruction of Purkinje cells. Neuropathy is the most frequent complication. Again, middle-aged males, long-standing abuse. It's not just nutritional, because sometimes develops in abusers with normal nutritional status. And the pattern of nerve fiber loss is different from beriberi and SSD. And it is more painful. And there is a lot of paresthesias, dysesthesias, mixed sensory motor, both kind of sensory losses seen, and wasting is limited to distal feed. Trophic changes can be seen, and pathologically there is axonal loss. There is no specific treatment except abstinence, vitamins, and diet, and carries a poor prognosis. Myopathy, now there are 3 forms at least described in literature. The first being a painless proximal weakness, which is a strong association with hypokalemia, although there is some elevation of CK, and pathologically we've seen single fiber necrosis and vacuolation, and it gets better with potassium replacement. An acute alcoholic myopathy is more like the rhabdomyolysis, with severe pain, tenderness, and edema. And again, likewise, can have myoglobinuria, and patients can die due to myoglobinuric renal failure. We time and again come across this chronic painless weakness and atrophy of proximal muscles of the limbs. It is an insidious, progressive, likely direct toxic effect, but there hasn't been enough data to confirm this. Then we have this entity of tobacco alcohol amblyopia, which is a syndrome of visual loss caused by selective lesions of the papillomacular bundles, originally seen in prisoners of war and Strachan syndrome, and then described infrequently in alcoholics as well. It's an insidious, symmetrical visual loss with impaired visual acuity, secocental scotoma, and patients have dyspallor. But we've not been able to prove either tobacco or alcohol as directly pathogenic, so the term is probably incorrect, and patients improve with vitamins and diet, and some of the patients improve in spite of continued drinking and smoking. And we all know this, another intriguing syndrome, originally described in Italians who used to drink red wine, but not restricted to just that group anymore, middle-aged, with selective demyelination of corpus callosum. We all know it can present as both confusional state or dementing syndrome, and MRI showing selective involvement of central corpus callosum with diffusion restriction, but patients can also have involvement of other white matter tracts and cerebellar peduncles. And this entity of alcoholic dementia, certainly is alcohol responsible for the atrophy and dementia? It's often widely and indiscriminately used, but majority of the patients have been found to have Korsakoff psychosis. Korsakoff may not be subacute, it can sometimes come insidiously, and some of them, in many studies, there have been many studies, some of them there have been no pathological examination, and majority, as I said, were found to have changes of Korsakoff syndrome. And in some studies, many diseases which are related or unrelated to alcoholism, but uniformly we have found reduced mean brain weight in alcoholics and pericerebral spaces. But again, atrophy is a very non-specific sign, but there have been recent studies since 2017 showing increased incidence of cognitive decline in alcoholics who have 14 or more drinks per week, and more than 60 gram alcohol for men and more than 40 gram per day has also been associated with increased risk of cognitive decline. And then we have this fetal alcohol syndrome. We all know there is more, the mortality is more amongst children of drunken mothers, and it is embryo toxic as well as teratogenic effects. And the infants are small in length and below third percentile. And several types of anomalies involving the face, involving the hands and the arms, and minor anomalies of the heart, genitalia, and lip, palate have been seen. And the infants are poor sucking, sleepy, irritable. And then when these children have been followed up for a long duration, they've been found to be distractive, inattentive, have ADHD, mental retardation, and behavioral abnormalities. In the rats, we've shown loss of millions of neurons in the developing fetus, and there is also impaired synaptogenesis shown. And it's one of the leading causes of mental retardation in the Western world. And then the last two, neurological complications of cirrhosis and portal systemic shunts, we have decided to have a separate lecture on this. And we all know central pontine myelinonysis, although we're not sure whether directly caused by alcohol, is very frequent with alcoholism. And it can be mild to severe with quadriplegia, pseudobulbar palsy with nystagmus and pupillary sparing. And in pathogenesis, we all know that when there is decreased serum tonicity, extracellular water will shift into cells with cerebral edema. And then there is a compensatory removal of intracellular solutes to reduce this edema. And then when we suddenly reduce this, give sodium correction, brain is unable to recapture the lost osmolytes. And then there is dehydration of brain tissue, leading to demyelination of white matter. We all know the lesions are seen in basis pontis, and at times it can be extrapontine. There's no specific treatment really except reintroduction of hypokeratinemia and MRI showing classic lesions in diffusion as well as T2 flare. Doesn't carry a very good prognosis, and prevention is by extreme slow correction. My last slide, very important. We should also address alcohol dependence treatment. We should establish rapport with the patient, set up scheduled visits, and even general specialists can do. We don't need dedicated psychiatrists and psychologists. We have to point out the problem, offer empathic advice, and we have to have admission to detoxification in special hospital unit, rehabilitation, aversion treatment, and we all know the drugs used in the form of disulfiram, naltrexone, and a camprosate. And recently, topiramate has also shown to block addicting effects of alcohol on mesolimbic dopaminergic system. So I hope I have covered most of the areas, although briefly, but I've tried to cover most of the important points. What I had to say, thank you very much. And here are my references. Thank you. Thank you again. Off to Dr. Batra.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful and a concise lecture. Alcohol is a very common topic practically as well as for a lot of other theoretical answers, and thank you so much for covering so much in such a limited time. We now move on to our next speaker, Dr. Tarun Nagpal, sir. He's a practicing urologist in Jabalpur, and he'll be speaking to us on organophosphorus and its neurotoxicity along with the electromyographic and electrophysiological findings as well. Over to you, Dr. Nagpal, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Batra. And I think, am I audible and my slides are visible?
Yes, sir. Yes. Your slides are visible and you are perfectly well audible.
Fine. So we start with the topic on organophosphorus poisoning. So this presentation is aimed at knowing how different organophosphorus compounds cause poisoning with the key concepts of conpharmacology. How does the poisoning evolve in time duration and some evidence-based management guidelines and limitations? And you will find some key points as diamonds in the presentation, which are for the exam going students. Grab them because these are unusual points and they will set you apart. The presentation is the outline of this answer is on introduction, then pharmacokinetics of the OP compounds, the mechanism of actions, some clinical features, diagnosis, how to treat it, prognosis, and summary. So this is the outline of your answer, how it should be. Organophosphorus compound is an organic compound containing a phosphate group. They are mostly pesticides or insecticides. And sometimes you may be asked in the Viva about carbamate poisoning. This is the same as OP compound poisoning. There are two minor differences, which I'll enumerate as I go in the presentation. And as with all poisonings, this can occur accidentally in occupation, or it could be a suicidal attempt. Now, the list is huge of organophosphorus compound poisons, but they are broadly described into these four groups. And you need to know which group does the patient has come with, and because the prognosis and the treatment would vary if it is a dimethylated or a diethylated group or an S-alkyl group. So out of more than 100 compounds, you have highly toxic compounds which are used as agriculture insecticides, the intermediate toxic compounds which are used as animal insecticides, and the less toxic ones are for household applications. But all of them can cause accidental or suicidal poisoning. Now we go to the pharmacokinetics. It is the ingestion can occur accidentally in the farms. It can occur in the lawns. It can occur in the insecticide control during the manufacturing process, in the food and the water supply. The absorption is either by the skin, by ingestion, by the GI route, or the inhalation through the nasal route. Most OP compounds are highly lipid soluble, and they can get absorbed from the intact skin, mucous membranes, conjunctiva, the gastrointestinal respiratory tract. They are rapidly distributed to all the body tissues, have high concentration in the liver and kidney, and because they are very lipid soluble, They cross the blood-brain barrier and have very potent CNS effects, which we'll see. Metabolism is in the liver, and elimination is in the urine, feces, and bile. Now, the difference between an organophosphorus and a carbamate compound toxicity, which I had mentioned, was that organophosphate insecticides are irreversible cholinesterase inhibitors, while carbamates are the reversible cholinesterase inhibitors. And the clinical signs and symptoms of poisonings with both these classes is nearly similar because the target is the same. But carbamates do not produce CNS toxicity because they do not have CNS penetration. And hence, you will have more problems with dealing with organophosphates than in carbamates. And where else have you learned about these acetylcholinesterase inhibitors? This is just to jog your brain. In snake bites, yes. In myasthenia gravis, we have acetylcholine receptor, and we have pyridostigmine to treat it as an antidote in Dhatura poisoning. And of course, acetylcholine is important in dementia. So we have drugs which act upon there in dementia and Alzheimer's dementia. So just to jog your brain, where else you find this enzyme? So how does organophosphorus compounds, they act? See, normally the acetylcholinesterase, they hydrolyze the acetylcholine into choline and acetic acid. So acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter. It is broken down by acetylcholinesterase, which is there in the synapse, and it stops acting. But what organophosphorus insecticides would do is they will bind to acetylcholinesterase, and this will make them inactive. So there's more acetylcholine now to act at the receptor, and this causes overstimulation. So increased acetylcholine at the synapse, the overstimulation causes disruption of the transmission. That is why you have all the adverse effects. Now, what happens to the OP compound which binds to the acetylcholinesterase? The acetylcholinesterase can have three fates. One is it can undergo an endogenous hydrolysis and can regenerate. Second is you give up enzyme, another nucleophile called PAM, which we use in OP compound poisoning as treatment, and regenerate your acetylcholine receptors. Or there's something known as aging. Aging is then when this acetylcholinesterase, they undergo an irreversible bonding with OP compound, and they can no longer be activated by PAM. So we know acetylcholine is a common neurotransmitter which is there in the parasympathetic as well as in the sympathetic stream. In parasympathetic, it's in the growth at the preganglionic and in the postganglionic sites. In the sympathetic, it is in the preganglionic as well as some of the postganglionic sites. At other places, we get norepinephrine. So the toxicity is mediated by increased acetylcholine. It is cholinergic toxicity, basically. So there's increased bradycardia, bronchoconstriction, meiosis at the parasympathetic end. There's sweating, there's midriasis, and at the neuromuscular junction, where there is, when the acetylcholine levels go up, there are fasciculations and weakness. At the brain level, there's agitation, confusion, coma, and seizures. Once again, if we see that the clinical features can be cataloged into by this mnemonic. For the muscarinic side effect, either you use the mnemonic sludge, BBB, or you use the mnemonic dumbbells, whichever you like. And this, you get increased salivation, lacrimation, defecation, urination, gastric emesis, bronchorrhea, bronchospasm, bradycardia. These two mnemonics don't cover the nicotinic effects, which is fasciculations, and CNS effects, which is lethargy. Once again, the symptoms and signs of cholinergic toxicity, increased acetylcholine, can be grouped into the muscarinic receptors, the nicotinic receptors, and the central receptors, where acetylcholine is overacting, and you have cardiovascular, respiratory, GI, GU, ICE, cardiovascular and musculoskeletal side effects, and the central effects of convulsions, ataxia, restlessness, and coma. The WHO has classified the severity into mild, moderate, and severe, depending upon the clinical features, but also if you have an available level of the acetylcholinesterase, it can be measured. And based on these three levels, you can classify the severity of the organophosphorus compound poisoning. The type 1, now I come to the clinical fiction, type 1, which is the acute cholinergic crisis. There are cardiac arrhythmias, myocardial ischemia, respiratory failure, neuromuscular junction, neuromuscular weakness, excessive respiratory secretions and bronchoconstrictions. And the paralysis seen is because of persistent depolarization because of increased accumulation of acetylcholine at the neuromuscular junction. So, fascinations, cramps, twitchings, and weakness. And here the patient may require respiratory support because of respiratory dysfunction. And if not supported, there will be a respiratory arrest. Now, the second, which is very important, is the type 2, which is intermediate syndrome. 10 to 40% of patients in 24 to 96 hours after the initial poisoning, they will go on to develop a proximal weakness of the limbs. They have the neck muscle weakness, so it is supposed to be a neuromuscular junction problem, and these are the dimethyl group of poisons which usually land up into the intermediate poisons, intermediate syndromes. It is not seen with carbon poison. These patients require ventilation for 2 to 3 weeks, and these patients have their symptoms correlating with the RBC cholinesterase levels, and their electrophysiology is unique, like a myasthenic syndrome. And if you do a repetitive nerve stimulation, it leads to decremental response, and this correlates with a respiratory failure. Once again, the type 2 intermediate syndrome is a weakness of the muscles of respiration, weakness, proximal muscle weakness, cranial nerve abnormalities, reflexes, and occurring 20 to 48 hours into the brain for dimethyl. And then these patients induced delay not to the acetylcholine. And this presents as a sensory present here. This is a flathead weakness, mostly.
Dr. Batra, are you there?
Hello.
Hello.
Am I in contact?
Yes, you were actually logged out of the meeting, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Where did I lose the contact? From what slide? You have to guide me. Are my slides visible now?
Dr. Pujari or Dr. Batra will be...
Sir, please, we can't see your screen. Can you share your screen?
My screen is not shared, is it?
Not shared now yet. You will have to do it again, sir.
Can you see my...
I think there's some net problem also, Mansi, connectivity. I can't hear him clearly.
Do you want to call up Dr. Nagpal and talk to him, Dr. Batra?
I think he has just started screen sharing. I don't have his... Now we can see the screen, sir. Yeah.
You can see the screen now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Tell me the slides where till which I was visible.
Yes, sir. Can you go till that three severities of poisoning?
Okay. This was covered?
Yes, sir. This was covered. Yeah, I think you can start from intermediate. I think you can start from intermediate again.
Okay. So I start from this slide again. So yeah. We are on intermediate syndrome. 10 to 40% of the patients will go on to develop symptoms of proximal weakness, neck muscle weakness, absent reflexes, cranial nerve abnormalities. And sensory impairment is not a manifestation of intermediate syndrome. There are no fasciculations. It supposedly is a neuromuscular junction problem, unlike the type 1 syndrome. And it is not seen with carbamate poisoning, requires ventilation for 2 to 3 weeks. And these patients, they correlate with RBC cholinesterase levels, which we discussed earlier. They have a peculiar electrophysiology, which we'll discuss later. Once again, intermediate syndrome is a weakness of the muscles of respiration involving the diaphragm, the intercostal nerves.
Sir, your internet network seems to be unstable.
Digital, and it is sensory. So you can't.
Hello.
Hear me? Hello.
Yes, I'm sorry to interrupt, sir. Your internet network seems to be unstable, and we are not able to hear you clearly.
Can you hear me?
Now we can hear you, sir. Yeah, please continue, sir. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have changed the network to another thing. Just tell me whether this is getting better.
Yeah, this is better, sir. Yeah.
Yes, this is better, sir.
This is better? Okay. Yeah. You can see the screen still?
Yes, sir. Yes,
you can see
sir.
My screen still?
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Only we'll have to move to the full screen mode.
Yeah. So I is this better? If it is not, you tell me in between. Okay.
Yes, sir.
The OP-induced delayed polyneuropathy is a distal involvement. Usually, the sensory involvement is a feature of OP-induced delayed polyneuropathy, and you get bilateral foot drop. And here, the pathophysiology is a sensory motor distal axonalopathy, and parathion is something which causes cholinergic toxicity, but not OPIDP. So there are different agents which would cause the type 1 syndrome, or some will cause the type 2 syndrome, some will cause type 3 syndrome. The DOPE, which I just mentioned, was as a new syndrome. In what happens is the patients are initially conscious, and then they progress to coma over the next 4 to 5 days, surprisingly. And here, these patients may start not only develop coma, but they may develop extrapyramidal features. CT scan and CSF has been found to be normal. They have low pseudocholinesterase levels, and they have increased atropine requirements. But they have a very good prognosis. So despite the coma, you should continue to treat them. Because here what is happening is the acetylcholine is not getting regenerated as fast as it is being released. The OP is released by the lipid stores. Next, another important thing, which is a diamond, is a copind. Here, the problem is not acetylcholinesterase. Here, the problem is a permanent CNS damage because of repeated exposures to OP compounds. And these patients may have personality change or psychiatric problems. The diagnosis is clinical. No one would forget the particular garlic spill he had witnessed in such patients in the casualty. If there is no history of exposure obtained, the clue is the cholinergic crisis. And these crises may occur in variable times depending upon the exposure. means whether it's an inhalation exposure or it is a dermal exposure. Once OP compound is suspected, poisoning is suspected, you need to get the dabba on which it is, you want to know the specific compound because you want to classify it into the dimethyl group versus the diethyl group. Dimethyl group are the ones which act rapidly. They rapidly age. So oximes will not be useful if you give it late. While the diethyl group have a delayed toxicity and hence it will be something like a prolonged battle. The pharmacological diagnosis comes with atropine, which is an antidote sort of thing. So you give atropine, these patients do not become tachycardic immediately. Giving atropine, they keep tolerating atropine. That is one of the clues that these patients have suffered something like an OP compound poisoning, even if the history is not available. If the labs are available, which usually are not, you do an RBC, acetylcholinesterase levels, which give a clue to the effectiveness, or a plasma cholinesterase, also known as the pseudo or the butyl cholinesterase. But this is just a value, does not usually correlate with the severity. And this is a good table to tell you what is plasma and what is RBC acetylcholinesterase. So one of them correlates well, but is difficult to obtain. That is the RBC one. And plasma butyl is available for assay, but does not correlate well with the neuronal activity. The electrophysiology, I'm telling you just a small bit because even the time is constrained. Patients with acute organophosphate compound will have increased acetylcholine burden at the receptors, at the synapse. So there will be repetitive CMAPs with a single stimulation. Those on repetitive stimulation, there is usually no decrement with if you give a slow stimulation, but at 30 hertz, a repetitive nerve stimulation will correlate with a decrement, even in the absence of paralysis. Phrenic nerve studies have been shown to correlate with the respiratory failure. The management is important. As always, remove contaminated clothing. Give gastric lavage in conscious patients. In unconscious patients, there's a risk of aspiration. So you have to be careful. If the patient requires intubation, avoid succinylcholine because it is something which causes persistent depolarization. And give oxygenation and, if required, do an endotracheal intubation. The pharmacological treatment is atropine. Very important is there's been a trial and it has shown that atropine needs to be given in titrating doses depending upon the patient's condition and not as fixed dose regimes, which increase the mortality. And tachycardia and midbrasses are not contraindication to use of atropine. The endpoint should be the respiratory secretions. Atropine does not bind to nicotinic receptors and has no role in the neuromuscular junction dysfunction, which occurs in type 2. Glycopyrrolate can be used, but the problem is glycopyrrolate does not have any CNS penetration, so it will not be useful if the patient is having delirium. Oximes are the antidotes. They have to be administered with atropine. So you start atropine, start oximes. Oximes should not be given without concurrent atropine because they can worsen the situation. And it has to be given as a bolus followed by an infusion. And there have been trials with oximes, which some of the trials have shown no benefit, but there's one trial which showed a mortality benefit. And reactivation happened more with diethyl group than in the dimethyl group. And dimethyl group, you have to act really rapidly for the oximes to have an effect. Otherwise, there'll be aging of the enzyme. There have been trials on FFP in OP poisoning. Needless to say, they have not been very successful. The idea was to give butyl cholinesterase through the FFP. Magnesium sulfate trials have been done, because they block the calcium channels and reduce the acetylcholine release, but not found to be very effective. Seizures have to be treated with diazepam and not phenytoin. There is a consensus that phenytoin may not be used because it has got a membrane stabilizing effect. So use diazepam for treating the seizures. Long-term neurotoxicity, again a diamond coming there, is an organophosphate is associated poisoning has been correlated with Alzheimer's disease, with Parkinson's disease, with ADHD. And you can remember that there is polymorphism on PON1 gene for peroxisomase 1 is associated with increased risk of Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease in people exposed to OP compounds. So there's a genetic basis of it. There's only one study which says that GCS less than 13 meant a poor prognosis. And most of the poisoning will depend upon the type, the group in which you see, what type of OP compound the patient has consumed. There are groups which are caused more of cholinergic. There are groups which cause more of type 2. And phenytoin and parathion are lipophilic, more the CNS toxicity and the delayed in the effect. So remember, as a summary, there are three types of paralysis. Do not miss in your answer. You talk about dope, you talk about copaint, that will give you marks. Identify the poison. Remember the nicotinic, the muscarinic, and the CNS side effects I told you about. And management, write that the incremental dose of atropine has to be given and not a fixed dose. Write about oximes. It is, even though it is controversial, it is an antidote which has to be given early. And magnesium sulfate and FFP require more research. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You can take over, please. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Nagpal, sir. It's a beautiful lecture. I think apart from the students, I think most of us who have done their MD medicine and maybe forgotten how to treat OP after a long hiatus, it was a great lecture to have for a practical use as well. And thank you so much for your wonderful contribution today evening, sir. So now
thank
we,
you.
Yeah. So now we move on to the next speaker, Dr. Pramod Dhonde. He'll be speaking on neurolathyrism. So pretty, let's say very earlier, it was one of the very important differentials of spastic paraparesis or quadriparesis in a crippling disease. So I think over to Dr. Dhonde to enlighten us on this wonderful aspect of infection or toxin related neurological disorder. Dr. Dhonde, please. Mansi? Hi.
Yes, I'm there. I'll help.
Fine.
Yeah, 1 minute. Mansi, am I visible?
Yeah, we can see you, Dr. Dhonde. Screen share karein.
You are audible and visible.
Yeah, I think we can see your screen now.
Is my screen visible now?
Yes, we can see your screen. Can you? Yeah, now we can see it.
Okay, fine. Thank you, Dr. Sripad and team Fine, for giving me the opportunity. I will just start with the lecture because we are already getting late. Neurolathyrism is it's like a history. So we have to just revise the history and we have to go ahead what we can learn from this concept, this disease of neurolathyrism. So according to, I will just discuss this lecture in this following concept. This is history and introduction, clinical features, pathology and pathogenesis, and differential diagnosis and management.
Dr. Dhonde, can you just resize the, and we are just able to see a part of the screen.
Okay, 1 minute. Yeah, is it okay?
We can't still see the, it's as if the screen has been zoomed. I mean, that's what I can see. I mean, maybe.
Okay, 1 minute. It has been zoomed?
It looks as if it has been zoomed.
You're right, sir. Screen is it is stretched and it is going beyond the dimensions of the screen.
Yeah.
1 minute.
Yeah, maybe you can minimize it a bit more.
1 minute.
So maybe you could move to the regular mode instead of the full screen mode.
Okay. Is it okay? Is it okay?
No, it is the same, sir.
Minimize it a bit more, I think.
You can escape the full screen mode.
Okay, 1 minute. Once again, I will stop share. Okay. Now visible?
You have to share your screen once again.
Okay, 1 minute. Sorry for the delay. It's not now visible?
Yeah, it's visible, but no. I think the same thing. I mean,
so it is still going beyond the screen.
Dr. Batra, are you able to see the full screen?
No. I am also able to see only the partial half part of the screen.
One minute.
So what you could do is you could just share your entire screen. So like right now you're opening.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah,
and now, you now can just close the side panel.
It's okay now.
Yeah, can you show the next couple of slides?
Yes. Can you move ahead? Yes, yeah, perfect.
Perfect. Okay, yeah. Fine. Right, thank you. Sorry for the delay.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah.
Actually, this Lathyrus sativus is called Kesari Dal in India. It's a staple crop in South Asia, Ethiopia, and China. Lathyrism and Konzo are... One second. Lathyrism and Konzo, these are the similar diseases associated with consumption of two different food plants. That is grass pea, that is Lathyrus sativa, or cassava. Cassava that is seen more of in this South African countries like Zambia, then Ethiopia. These are the cassava is the one of the food that is very commonly used and that causes similar kind of toxicity that is called Konzo. Both causes permanent symmetric spastic paraparesis. Neurolathyrin is now a history, never be a challenge in the future in view of the vast public awareness, and always surface only during the extreme situations such as famine and drought. Lack of availability of alternative foods and similar trends both suggest a similar pathogenic mechanism. So this is one of this is the seed which we are seeing in the picture. This is called Kesari Dal. These are the different kind of forming from dal to that is seed, that is flower that is shown. And this is the area where it is native in, this is Yugoslavia, that is a native plant. And from there onwards, different parts of the world, which we are seeing, it is that is going from that side to this other parts of the country, other parts of the world. In Madhya Pradesh, this is the folk that is talked about this Kesari Dal or Lathyrus sativa. That is called Matra in Madhya Pradesh. That is called Karya Matra Peer Nisan, Uske Khaye Se Gor Nisan. Hale Chandi Matke Kuli, Ye Dekho Matra Ke Shul. In fact, that the meaning of this is the black pea with its yellow floor. From it, it comes trouble in the legs. Flapping top knot and swaying hips, behold the ill effects of eating Matra. This is one of the folk that was told about this ill effects of Lathyrus sativa, which was commonly used in MP. Lathyrism is caused by excessive consumption of seeds of legume called Lathyrus sativa containing neurotoxic agent, that is B-N-oxalyl amino L-alanine, that is what we call it as BOAA. The toxic effects of Lathyrus sativa, these are mainly shown in 19, these are the two papers which are beautifully done, the studies, which is one of the study that is done in Indian Institute of Science from Department of Biochemistry and other from Department of Chemistry, Delhi University in 1963. The both papers show that Lathyrus sativa contains this one of the C compound, that is BOAA, which is, the studies are absolutely fantastic. If you go into the details of these studies, it is very difficult to see these kind of studies nowadays. Its toxic effects are on the cortical motor neurons, causing degeneration of corticospinal tract and progressive spastic paraparesis. Epidemiology, if we go to the epidemiology, I will not go into the epidemiology of other parts of this world. We will just focus on what is happening in the India. So if we go to the epidemiology, this topic which I have brought, this the topic I have taken from the one of the books from written by Dr. Professor N.H. Wadia. The topic was written by Professor K.K. Sinha from North Bihar or Ranchi and Professor N.H. Wadia himself. According to K.K. Sinha, who saw many epidemics in North Bihar as a medical student in 1950s, has not seen an authentically diagnosed new case over the last 25 years of his practice. So this was the personal experience by Dr. Professor K.K. Sinha. From MP, if we can see, there are different case reports by Handley, Acton, then Buchanan, Shauri, Roy, Dwivedi Prasad. These are the different case reports they have given from UP, Bihar, and even Maharashtra. Maharashtra, this is Amgaon district, Bhandara. They have the this Professor Kulkarni has personally done the survey of, this is a personal experience, there is not published case, this is a personal experience what he has been told, 10 villages and around 136 cases were detected where exclusive consumption of Lathyrus was there. So this is the epidemiology we can learn. If you go into the book by written by Professor N.H. Wadia on this topic, you go into the history, history is beautifully written like just like a story. If you go on reading, you will love it. So the clinical features of this neural atherism are mainly pure spastic paraparesis, that is selective affects UMN upper motor neurons causing a pure spastic paraparesis similar to primary lateral sclerosis. Onset and course depend on the concentration of Lathyrus consumed and concentration of toxin within. Males are more affected than females with the incidence highest below 30 years. Children are relatively spared. Acute spastic paraplegia with pains around lumbar and knees. The onset can be acute spastic paraplegia, but initial precedence was pains around lumbar and region and knees is the preceding factors. So the clinical presentation can be like this. Severe cramps often accompany or herald paralysis, which are precipitated by physical effort or exposure to inclement weather. The disease progresses if continued legume consumption. On examination, you get severe lower limb spasticity, symmetrical weakness, scissoring gait. There was one of the 1922, Acton has suggested four stages of this neural atherism. That is, one stage is called no stick stage. Other stage is called one stick stage. Third stage was two sticks, and last was crawler stage. So these are the four stages which has been described. Go on the that increases the increases this indicates the severity of spasticity as this going on increasing if we continue the legume consumption. Upper limb involvement, sensory and bladder symptoms are little bit infrequent though they are reported. Mild peripheral nervous system nerve dysfunction has been noted in anecdotal case report. It is also uncommon with this neural atherism. Pathology and pathogenesis, we go on to this. In 1962, Professor Dastur from JJ Hospital reviewed literature of two patients with these cases of latharism, one Indian and one Russian, where mean degeneration was found in corticospinal tracts with secondary gliosis. There were similar changes in posterior columns and lateral spinocerebellar tracts. In 1969, Sachdeva et al. Described an autopsy in one of the patients where there was demyelination noted in the posterior to half of the lateral corticospinal tracts. These are the pathological, some of the these pathological autopsy reports were there. So what is the pathogenesis? The effect and cause relationship has been established by, this is one of the best paper that this paper has established the effect and cause. The Peter Spencer, Peter Spencer group has also proven the etiopathogenesis of this BMAA, that is Conzo, causing spastic paraparesis in South African countries. So this is the paper where they have compared, they have taken the toxin, they have injected into macaws, that is monkeys, and they have shown that in man, prolonged consumption of this produces spastic paraparesis, which is commonly seen, this is similarly seen in these macaws also. And it was thought to be a potent glutamate excitotoxic, drug, that is BOA is a toxic toxin. And it produces seizures and acute neuronal toxicity at high doses. But at this lower doses, which is consumed in humans, that causes only spastic paraparesis. And the similar changes has been seen. This is just a cousin. You can see it's a brother of this BMMA, which produces similar kind of illness in these patients in Conzo. So these are the possible culprits of BOAA. This can produce cyanide-induced damage. This can promote the cyanide-induced damage. This Kesari Dal is deficient in sulfur amino acid, compromises cyanide metabolism. And there is another mechanism, that is nitriles, has been also proposed as one of the toxicity that is causing spastic paraparesis. Mechanisms of toxicity, that is excitotoxicity, which we have already discussed. LBOS is a stereospecific glutamate receptor. Non-N-methyl-D-aspartate receptor that is causing, leading to central neurotoxicity, glutamate toxicity via direct glutamate receptor O stimulation. Oxidative stress, free radical oxygen species generation and leading to this toxicity. Inhibition of tyrosine aminotransferase by LODAP, that is also called BOAA. And nitriles has direct neurotoxic actions not mediated by systemic cyanides. The degeneration in cortical neurons is due to BOA, a glutamate agonist, and its actions are mediated through AMPA class of receptors located on specific neurons and their dendrites. Mishra and Sharma found considerable slowing of central conduction time in some patients suggested affecting this large corticospinal pathways. There are different, these are some of the studies which have been conducted in Indian scenario also, which are showing delayed conduction time, central conduction time, suggesting affection of large corticospinal pathways in these patients of latharism. So in differential diagnosis, this is the table which I have been taken from one of the chapter by Gustavo Roman written in Handbook of Neurological Diseases. This Gustavo Roman's reference recently has been taken by one of the lecture from recently by a Turkish professor in encephalitis, which has beautifully written this chapter in these books. If we see this differential diagnosis, I am not going to go into these types of this congenital, traumatic, tumor, vascular, then multiple sclerosis, inflammatory infections, bacterial and fungal and viral. We are just going to see this neurotoxicity related or malnutrition related things. TSP, that is topical spastic paresis, that is common associated findings are optic and hearing defects probably caused by neurological syndromes during World War II. And neurotoxicity, that is latharism, then cyanide, excessive cassava consumption common in Nigeria and Tanzania causes conzo and tropical spastic paraparesis. Clioquinol, that is causing subacute myelooptic neuropathy in Japan, which was the clioquinol was the drug which are used for deworming. And organophosphates and pesticide, which we have recently seen, may cause tropical ataxic neuropathy. And later on, they can, over the period of time, develop spasticity also. Other problems, that is familial paraplegia and syringomyelia. So in a differential, basic to grossly differential diagnosis are toxic nutritional myelopathies, that is tropical ataxic neuropathy, conzo, Cuban and epidemic myeloneuropathy. These are toxic, the common features of these three are retrobulbar optic neuropathy, sensory neural deafness, predominantly sensory and autonomic neuropathy and dorsolateral myelopathy. And toxic myeloneuropathies are like this cyanide, which we are seeing cassava, and fluorosis is also one of the cause for toxic myeloneuropathies. So current status and prevention in this neurolatherism, it's already a history. So there is no many cases now we are seeing with neurolatherism. In 1960, central and state government imposed a ban on the trade of kesari dal seed through partially implemented kesari dal, kesari seeds. Though partially implemented, was successful. By 1977 and 78, production was dropped to 3 lakh tons. In 1998, there was one forum started, that is International Network for the Improvement of Lathrus Sativa for Eradication of Latharism, that is called INLCEL, started project for developing this strain free from toxicity, but somehow remained inconclusive. And in 1991, Department of Home Science and Academy of Nutrition Department had concluded in one of the meeting in Nagpur that ban to be lifted, consumption up to 125 to 150 gram is safe, with 80 to 19% of BOA can be removed by simply soaking the seed in overnight water and also mixing with cereals. So these were the recommendations given in 1991. In 1922, Acton recommended following actions for prevention of the disease. Decrease amount of kesari dal consumption by providing famine relief during a poor monsoon. Increasing knowledge regarding the toxicity of grain. Soak the grain for 24 hours in 3 changes of water so that it can remove the toxin. What we believed after experiments was a water-soluble toxin. Improve agricultural methods and encourage plentiful alternate crops of rice and wheat and ban exploitation of poor laborers. So these are the basic recommendations which are definitely helpful for any kind of, you can say, the toxic disease, toxin-related disease. These recommendations can be helpful for neurolatherism as well as any kind of other disease also. So investigations in this disease, there are no specific tests to diagnose latherism. MRI, CSF blood tests are to rule out mimickers. Treatment is damage is irreversible, so mainstay of management being symptomatic relief, pharmacological, antispasticity drugs, baclofen, tizanidine, diazepam, clonazepam. Physical therapy is walking aids and physiotherapy are the basic treatment modalities. So these are my references. One of the references I want to quote again, that latherism from neurological practice by N.H. Wadia and K.K. Sina. This is one of the best chapter you can read from this book. Tropical myelopathies, Gustav Roman in a handbook of neurology by Joe. This is by Jose Biller. So this is one of the very beautiful topic you can read on from tropical myelopathies. And these are lessons from neurolatherism. These are the one of the case reports and all the history of this latherism and future of Lathrus sativus has been written in one of the Indian Journal of Medical Research 2013. I just want to end with these two things which are very helpful for your exam going students. This is a lychee encephalitis, which has been reported recently from Muzaffarpur, Bihar, because definitely you are going to get some question on this. So this is related to lychee encephalitis that is called due to hypoglycin A and MPCG toxicity. You can go onto the Lancet article about this lychee encephalitis so that you can get an idea and you have this prepared for this exam going students. And there is one new concept that is called I-cubed concept. I-cubed concept is this infection, inflammation, and immunity. These are the three I's which can make anything disease, any disease. Suppose if I can get recently we can see the Parkinson's disease. It has been thought that it is getting gut, it is getting some infection in the gut, and that is producing some synucleinopathy, and that is affecting the brain. So ultimately, it is infection that is causing altered inflammation, that is causing altered immunity. That is the basic problem in most of the diseases now. So this concept is going to get more and more we are going to see. And this concept will be able to understand many of the diseases in future. And I hand over to Dr. Dhruv Batra for the next talk. Thank you for the organizers for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Pramod Dhonde. It was a wonderful review, I would say, from the historical aspects, the epidemiological aspects, to the treatment, management, and mostly supportive care. But it was a beautiful journey. And I think, I don't know, maybe because of coronavirus and shortage or something, maybe can it come back? We don't know.
probably may not many of the things we are going to see in near future.
Again, yes. Okay.
Recently we are seeing many young strokes also. So you never know that what is happening now.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Dhonde, so much. And without wasting much time, we move on to our last speaker for the day, Dr. Jayendra Yadav. He'll be speaking on tropical ataxic neuropathy. I will hand over the medium over to Dr. Jayendra. Over to you, Dr. Jayendra. Yeah, Dr. Jayendra, can you hear me?
Hello?
Yeah, Dr. Jayendra, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, please. Yeah, please continue.
I'll start?
Yeah, please start. We are able to hear you perfectly. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Dhruv Batra. Myself, Dr. Jayendra Yadav. I'll be speaking on tropical ataxic neuropathy. This disease is similar to what Dr. Pramod sir have just covered, latherism. It's a disease related to the ingestion of food items containing toxins. He has already mentioned it's a cassava. So, tropical ataxic neuropathy is resulted because of cassava consumption. It is prevalent in tropical countries and it causes significant disability, but till now there is no effective treatment. This disease has been known for almost for more than a century, but still there are still speculation regarding how the pathogenesis and the effective treatment and preventive methods for this disease. This is a syndrome which was first described in Jamaica in 1897, and it was named as a tropical ataxic neuropathy in 1959 by Money, who attributed this to deficiency of thiamine and riboflavin. So, tropical ataxic neuropathy is a constellation of neurological affections, which include sensory polyneuropathy, sensory ataxia, bilateral optic atrophy, bilateral sensory neural deafness. There is also evidence of pyramidal and posterior collar involvement. And it is described in tropical countries, the African countries, and it has also been described in Indian. The other disease is a conserve. It is epidemic spastic paraparesis, and it is characterized by spastic paraparesis, occurs after several weeks of almost exclusive monotonic consumption of improperly processed bitter cassava roots. These two diseases, these are cassava related diseases. As cassava usually is ingested by the people who are people from the countries of lower socioeconomic status and drought hit countries. Because this cassava cassava grows very well even with the in bad soil with that essence without use of any fertilizers. Another reason why this is consumed by these dotted countries because it's this this food is cassava roots, the bitter cassava root. It is high in calorie, but it is poor in protein supplements and it is poor in certain vitamins like riboflavin, thiamine. That may be one of the contributing factors along with the presence of certain toxic material in this cassava. And this cassava grows better, in fact, in droughted areas. Yeah. And the bitter cassava, which is there, you know, the toxin content, you know, the in droughted areas during that period and seasons, you know, this toxin content of this cassava root increases. So if you see a global scenario, the highest this thing prevalence it has been described from the Nigeria. The incidence is almost to the tune of almost 64 per 10,000 individual, more common in females, 3:1 ratio. And it is more commonly seen in elderly people, like prevalence will be almost 24% in the age group between 60 to 69 years. The prevalence progressively increases with each decade and then declines after 70. As I said, like this is a disease of the tropical, like African countries. So, and this disease appears non-existent in temperate countries. Just a single single report from Birmingham, but that person was then was put in this sub-Saharan tropical countries during this prisoner days. So this is a graph which illustrates like which all countries have till now reported this tropical ataxic neuropathy. Usually you can see it's in African countries and tropical countries and hardly any cases reported from the temperate countries like United Kingdom, US or European countries. Coming to the epidemiology, Indian scenario. So this disease, TAN, is least reported neurological condition in India. First, Dr. Krishna Swamy and Kalam Nagalam has described it in 1975. It has also been described from southern part of India, Kerala. And it has shown same female preponderance as similar to what has been seen in African studies. But in India, this highest prevalence is seen it at the third decade as compared to the sixth decade, which has been noted in African studies. Coming to the clinical features of this syndrome, this tropical, which have been described. The first one is which is associated with a mucocannabinoid manifestation, which results because of the malnutrition, not directly related to the cassava ingestion, with retrobulbar neuropathy, and which improves with dietary modification, supplementation, autoclave dryness, and spinal ataxia. Second is like typical of tropical ataxic neuropathy. It is combination of sensory polyneuropathy, gait ataxia, optic atrophy, and sensory neural deafness. So in contrast to the adolescent syndrome, the second syndrome, mucocannabinoid manifestations of malnutrition are less frequent in this, and neurological symptoms do not respond to the dietary modification or even vitamin supplementation. clinical features. Dr. Netto has studied some cohort of this tropical ataxic neuropathy from January 1999 to 2015. They studied around 31 cases from Andhra and 2-3 from Tamil Nadu, and each one from Kerala and West Bengal. So, but Kerala is the only state among these which where cassava has grown. So 7 patients were men, 24 were women. Most of them were in the middle age group, and only two patients were less than 15 years, and one patient after 60 years. When we see the clinical feature, the most common presenting symptoms are around legs, and symptoms in the upper limb are seen in up to two-thirds or two to half of the patient, and they will complain of clumsy hands, all painful paresthesias. And sensory symptoms in the trunk have been in the form of gadapans, but no patient complaints of has ever noted to have a sensory level in this patient, in this cohort. So these are the like various studies, like what all symptoms have till now been described. Among all the which I already have listed, sensory symptom, visual symptoms, gait abnormality, weakness and lower symptoms are less common. And so when it comes, the exacerbation of symptoms occur during the rainy seasons. And as I already said, lower cranial nerve symptoms in the form of dysarthria, dysphagia, dysponia occur in minority patients. Dysponia was manifested as a high-pitched hypophonic voice with inability to shout. In two out of 84 patients by Osonto also reported night blindness. But this patient also had a coexisting vitamin A deficiency, so probably related to that. gait is typically wide-based and ataxic. Worsening in the night suggestive of sensory ataxia, and almost one third of these patients will ultimately will need some sort of a walking gait. So along with this, there will be, because cassava, this disease is seen in malnourished under poor people. So there will be also evidence of other malnutrition related symptoms like angular stomatitis, chilitis. Few patients have sensory neural hearing loss is noted. Gaze got nystagmus was seen in few patients. Apart from this sensory loss, loss in glove and stocking distribution, hyperparesthesia was also noted in a minority of the patient. The extrapyramidal affection is less commonly seen. Some of the patients in advanced diseases, primitive reflexes were noted, and two-thirds of the patients were dependent for mobility activities of daily living. When this patient was studied and admitted. So all these studies have, three studies which have been studied in detail by Netto et al. They have listed all these neurological physical examination findings till now. All these are already enumerated. So coming to the Conzo, Conzo is similar to the tropical ataxic neuropathy. There is a quite good overlap between the symptomatology of the two diseases. Conzo is also called as an epidemic spastic paraparesis, and it is characterized by the abrupt onset of paraparesis, which occurs after several weeks of cassava ingestion, bitter cassava ingestion, which contains more toxic compared to the sweet cassava. But unlike topical ataxic neuropathy, TN is a disease of elderly. Conzo is preferentially affecting children between 4 to 12 years of affection comes from tropical ataxic neuropathy with predominant pyramidal affection. So when these patients were studied, laboratory features which have been found are that there is normal hemoglobin and serum albumin, total protein albumin, which are like suggestive of protein nutritional aspect of the person. They were normal. So total serum level B12 also reported to be normal in tropical ataxic neuropathy. The serum cholesterol, which is the index of calorie consumption, it is on the lower side. Serum riboflavin was significantly lower in this patient cohort of patients. So this is one of the etiological factors which are said. Time is also what the imagination level. It is also one of the postulates of the pathologies of the pathology. The serum urine hypocyanate levels, which is an indirect signal, but significant in normal pleocytosis, but not more than electrophysiology studies, which confirms the evidence. It showed like motor conductions in the nerves of lower limb, but there's no conduction block. So, unlike lens of pseudo sensory nerve action potential in this patient, and which is suggestive of axonopathy. And there have been few studies which in which the pseudo nerve biopsy was done, and that confirmed presence of axonal injury. We studied electrophysiology in this patient, but they found few evidence of demyelination. In this patient, anterior tibial nerve biopsy was done, and which revealed perineural infiltration of lymphocyte, perineural fibrosis, but no effective explanation are found in these patients. So, but predominantly electrophysiology in these patients will be a sensory predominant axonal neuropathy. There has been various postulates regarding how this topical ataxic neuropathy result in patient with a cassava ingestion. So it has been attributed to malnutrition, B12 deficiency, cyanate intoxication, malabsorption, vegetarian diet, poor protein intake, and viral degenerative genetic factors have been, but no single factor have been implicated and proven conclusively. The most theory for the disease is the compound, the cassava. This cassava is the food security. These cyanogenic glycosides, they can be eliminated up to the cyanide reaches to higher level in body, and the cyanide then inhibits cytochrome and oxidase, cause a mitochondrial injury. Hello.
Yeah, Dr. Jayendra, we can't see your screen.
Acha.
Can you just share your screen?
Yeah. I'll share.
Yeah, now we can see. Yeah. If you could go to your last slide, whichever you played before the disconnection. Dr. Jayendra, can you hear me? Nancy? Dr. Jayendra, can you hear me? I think so. Dr. Jayendra?
Spot. I never asked. We do it here. We have needs. We want recognition.
Mansi, are you there?
क्या देख ये उसमें मुझे एक ये है ये एक अटैचमेंट था ईमेल आई वांट टू डाउनलोड इट ऑन माय मोबाइल कैसे करना है क्या करना है
जस्ट टैप ऑन इट
एक बार
एक बार हाँ टॉप राइट पे है ना डाउनलोड सिंबल टैप हो गया
आ गया होगा उसमें
हाँ जहाँ भी आपका फाइल दो होती
Does anyone have his contact number, Dr. Donde?
The download folder must be there. आगे आगे ऊपर ऊपर. दस्ते एक बार दोबारा.
ये वो पता नहीं है मुझे.
हमें समझा somebody's calling but. So I think you're not able to get through with Dr. Jayendra. I think we lost connection or something. So I think we can call it a day. In case anybody wants to, we have a couple of questions. In the meanwhile. So I think one of the questions is for Dr. Donde. Dr. Donde, you're there?
But you are not.
Dr. Donde, can you hear me?
Yeah. Hey, one minute. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, I am able to hear.
Yeah. So there's a question that why doesn't lathyrism affect the upper limbs?
Actually, upper motor, this the toxin, BOA toxin, that affects basically AMPA receptors. Mm. And AMPA receptors acts through, it's a glutamate excitotoxic drug. So, glutamate excitotoxicity might explain the preferential affection of the upper motor neurons rather than lower motor neurons. Because it's a mechanism which was... Yeah. Many of the motor neuron diseases like PLS and all these things. This is the reason that is affecting only mainly upper motor neurons.
Okay. Thank you. I think we'll take one last question. This is for Dr. Jayendra, if he's there or not. So is there any correlation between the Madras motor neuron disease?
Kala kaan se hai?
Tropical ataxic neuropathy.
Email khola tha. Sure.
I'm not sure if he's there or not. So, I think those were the two questions. So, fine. I think we'll it was a wonderful session and we had some amazing, unique, let's say, exotic or tropical topics today. And it was fascinating to hear all of you, all the speakers, Dr. Shripad sir, Dr. Tarun Nagpal sir, Dr. Pramod Donde sir, and Dr. Jayendra Yadav sir. So I think we'll just call it the end of the session. We have Dr. Subhash Kaul sir and Dr. Pavan Oja sir on the panel as well. So if they have any valuable inputs or any closing comments, if they would like to have some comments.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah, we can hear you, sir.
Yeah. So, it was a really great session. And, I was glued to the screen all throughout. So I didn't move. So I have, I really enjoyed it. And I just hope that, the technical glitches were not there. But all the speakers did a wonderful job. So very nice. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. Dr. Kaul, sir, is also with us. So if you would like to give some valuable inputs. I think... sir is there. I don't think he... Sir, you're there? Paul, sir? Fine. I think I don't think he can hear us. So thank you everyone and all the speakers for a wonderful Tuesday evening. I'm sure all the residents must have benefited a lot from these sessions and all the practicing clinicians as well. We have all these talks uploaded on our YouTube channel and they are available as PDFs as well. So we'll be making them available as soon as possible. Thank you, everyone. I think we'll call it a day. Good night.